I got a big goddamn problem with the news. You ready for this? The news is completely manipulated. Everything you hear every single day is designed by corporate media to do one thing and one thing only.
Jesus.
To keep you living in fear.
Oh, fear?
Total fear. Fear so you'll go out and you'll spend money on things. Things you probably don't even need. Things you probably already have six of. So that their advertisers can keep buying ads on their stations. I'll tell you one more thing. You ready for this? I'll do this all day, man.
For me, the meaning of life is to experience, to learn, to share, to grow, and then to move on. Those are the five core principles that I've tagged to the meaning of life. We are all here experiencing this reality. Every single one of us is experiencing something. No matter where you are on Earth or in the universe, you are experiencing a reality of some kind. So there's meaning to that. The second part is learning. From the day you are conceived, the day you are born, you are on a journey of learning. You learn how to talk, how to walk, how to read, how to write. You learn about where you are, who you are, why you're here, your family. You're constantly learning. Even when you think you're not learning, you're learning every single day, every second, every moment. The third part is sharing. You know, we, as humans, we have an innate need to want to share information, share knowledge. Hence we are on these platforms. Facebook, telephones are big parts of our lives because we are a species of wanting to share. And then there's growth. So again, with learning, with experience, with sharing, you are growing. And there's an element of decay. You are born, you live, you experience, you learn, you grow, and then we all die. That is a truth that we can all agree on. You know, there's no conspiracy theory there. Every one of us is going to pass on to something else that's not this reality, into another reality of some kind. All cultures and all religions pretty much allude to this if you read them in the right context, for sure. The Bible, the Vedic scriptures, all ancient spiritual cultures, the Dogon tribes, the Kemetic Egyptians, the Nordics, the Celtics, they all talked about this concept of reincarnation, coming back. That whole thing of growing and moving on. Every time you incarnate, you are a better version of what you were in your previous life, or you should be. This is where things, concepts like karma come into effect, universal laws come into effect. So there are many things at play. And this karma thing, I think, is a good one to tag, because this also plays into why we've been lied to about where we live, because it has a lot to do with controlling this reincarnation concept. All secrets and all lies that we're told, power and control. Knowledge is power. If you limit knowledge, you have the power, you control whoever you're limiting that knowledge from. So, to cut a long story short, there was a time when everyone knew that the earth was flat, and everyone knew the true construct of where we are and the magnificence of where we are. Unfortunately, the flat earth, because we're only starting to rediscover this truth, the information is very limited. But this earth is far larger and far more diverse than even the heliocentric model promotes, because the spinning ball model actually promotes that we are alone. We're on this ball, we're lost in space, and there's nothing else, and only the authorities can save us. NASA will find extraterrestrial lands and extraterrestrial beings and technologies and government. So we're reliant on authority. So we have no choice but to follow. However, when you know the true construct of our flat earth and you realize that there are lands here on earth beyond in places that we haven't rediscovered yet, that there are beings that live on this vast plane, not so far away from where we are, you then realize how it's easy to, or why it's necessary for the controllers or the elite who've been running this realm to lie to us about where we are. But also on a spiritual level, it is my understanding, or my inner standing rather, that the laws of reincarnation dictate that We all have free will. We're all free to choose, but we're not free from the consequences of our choices. So for instance, if I died right now, I think the universe would ask me, what do I want? This is the scenario that I picture. This is hypothetical, it's theoretical. I'm not saying it's fact, but this is how I've come to understand it. You are then asked, what do you want to do? Because you have free will. Now, if I only know that I live on a spinning ball, and this is the only place that I know, this is what I'm going to choose. I'm going to choose to come back to Earth because I don't believe there's anything else in the universe or anywhere else in the universe to go, right? I've limited my choices. So that's a choice. I've imprisoned myself back to this place. However, if you know that there are other lands, Hyperborea, Shambhala, Eden, you know, other beings and civilizations, you can choose to experience a different reality in your next incarnation. Right, so you now have freedom of choice. You have more choice, but no one can give you that choice. You have to make that choice. So knowledge is power. Control the knowledge, you have the power. You control the people. We're in the dark age. We're in the winter of consciousness. Hence, the world is such an ugly place. It's cold. We're frozen at the moment, consciously. So we are at the lowest peak of consciousness. So even though we tend to think we are far more superior than past cultures, we're not. We might be more technologically advanced, but technology, intellect, and gnosis, knowledge, are two different things. Just because you have technology does not make you more superior. Those are things we have to be very careful about. There's artificial intelligence and there's natural intelligence. So we've lost natural intelligence and we've somewhat gained artificial intelligence, and even that's been limited. History is so easy to rewrite. It's his story. The Earth is certainly flat and motionless, as far as I'm concerned. But we're not just in free space in the middle of nowhere. Like a lot of flat earthers are still stuck on that paradigm that it's flat, there is a dome above us, that's it. So I decided to go a step further and say there has to be a lot more to it. And after doing quite a bit of research, I realized that a lot of ancient cultures talked about life beginning in an egg, which is what we observe in nature. So this egg turns out to be an electromagnetic torus field. So again, a lot of the ancient cultures speak about this egg being covered by an egg, the Ouroboros. If you look at Hebrew texts, the Orphean egg in Greek mythology had this coiled snake around it. In Kemetic Egypt, the serpent Apep wrapped his arms around the egg of the universe. So you see this snake and egg concept to do with creation. And when I looked further into it, I realized that whenever you see a snake in ancient cultures, it's always depicting energy. So putting that into context, that energy, this egg, is an electromagnetic torus field that is cocooning us inside this universe with the outside, what we might call the multiverse. So outside this egg is the multiverse. And there are many, many other eggs, according to Vedic scriptures, mainly. So we're not the only universe. There are many, many other cosmic eggs inside the multiverse. But within our construct, we are bang in the middle. We are at the heart of this egg. Heart is an anagram for Earth, Earth heart. So we are right in the middle of this, the egg. We are the nucleus of this cosmic egg, this electromagnetic torus field. Now, this Earth that we're standing on is extremely vast. The Vedics say it's about 4 billion miles across. So they give a specific figure. They say it's about 4 billion miles across. And it's divided into four concentric rings. Right? So at the center, in the middle, is what we might call the Garden of Eden, Hyperborea, Shambhala. Many names have been given to this sacred place at the center. And I think at the moment it's a crater continent, and that's at the North Pole, as far as we're concerned, from our viewpoint where we are. And then you've got our realm where we are, and then outside us there is the South Pole, which is the Antarctica, which is a ring of ice that encircles our part of the realm. And beyond that, there is another ring of land. And beyond that, there is a lost ring of land. Now, all these lands are cocooned or covered by smaller electromagnetic torus fields. So like we said, the cosmic egg is one big giant electromagnetic torus field. And then there's a smaller electromagnetic torus field, and then a smaller one and a smaller one, similar to those Russian dolls. So each realm is cocooned by electromagnetic torus fields. Now, NASA and a lot of mainstream science, they tell us half-truths. So they're not complete liars, like a lot of flat earthers tend to believe that, oh, NASA, everything's a lie that you're told. I don't think so. They usurp the truth. They twist the truth. They tell us half-truths. So NASA quite clearly tells us that the Earth is covered by Van Allen belts, an electromagnetic field. This electromagnetic field, or Van Allen belt, is the belt that's outside in the Antarctica, beyond the ice wall. But there's a smaller one at the center, which we see, and we call the Aurora Borealis. That Aurora Borealis is an electromagnetic torus field, cocooning the central continent at the center, Hyperborea, or Shambhala. I think there are certainly openings that we can pass through, and that are, these are the openings that are guarded and kept secret. But I think the electromagnetic field, according to NASA, we cannot go past the Van Allen belts. NASA categorically says this. Humans, we do not have the technology to go past the Van Allen belts. There must be openings or maybe tunnels through the ice wall where we can bypass the electromagnetic field or something. Because there are stories of people who apparently gone beyond these lands and found these places. Admiral Byrd being right. One of them. He's been to the North Pole and the Antarctica, and he's seen lands, extraterrestrial lands, both on the outside and on the inside. If you believe that we have been visited by extraterrestrials in the past, in the future, or now, this model makes more sense than the heliocentric model, because they're closer to home, right? And the word itself, extraterrestrial, if you break down that word, extra means what? More of. Terrestrial, the root word of terrestrial, is terrain, land. So they're telling us the truth. Extraterrestrials are beings from extra terrains of land, from where we are. So for sure, there is a galactic agreement of some sort, I think, where these beings possibly are allowed to we interact with one another or on a government level, but they're not allowed to interfere, as we are not allowed to interfere with them. We're sort of just left to get on with our business separately. Again, I think that that the whole thing of the 12 universal laws, free will, you know, unless we consent and we choose to interact with them, they are not allowed to interact with us. And they know they're not allowed to break these universal laws, because there are consequences with breaking these universal laws. All these different realms are different dimensions with different frequencies, with different levels of consciousness, with different experiences. Some are lower vibratory frequency realms, some are higher vibratory frequency realms. But certainly everything begins from the center, the heart. Everything always begins from the heart, from the center. So the Garden of Eden, or the central realm, is the highest vibrational frequency. This is where you want to be going, really, if you're ascending. This is where the goal should be. And I think the further you are away from the center, and the further away you go to the outer lands, the less, the more dense it becomes. The more, I don't think they're hellish or evil places, but I think the less spiritual those places are, the more technological they are. So when I watch a lot of movies with all these highly advanced technology, like the recent one, Altered Carbon, that came out on Netflix, I imagine this is what these outer realms are like. Very highly technological, but zero spirituality. They've completely disconnected from nature, from spirituality. Everything is artificial, AI, which is where we're heading. They're trying to prepare us for that. You can see that in our everyday reality at the moment, trying to throw technology in our faces so we disconnect from nature, so we don't ascend to these higher realms, the central realm, or maybe even stay here, because this place is raising the vibration. They want people to go to these outer lands, to Mars, as we will go to, as we'll explain a bit later. So they want people to leave this realm where we are now and to go to outer space, the space outside where we are, the extraterrestrial lands beyond where we are, where it's a lot more dense and a lot more disconnected from nature. All religions, as far as I'm concerned, and many syncretists and many people who have mystics who have studied this in detail will tell you that religion, religious texts are truth, but they're not factual. So again, the Bible is a book of truth, but it's not a factual book. There are no facts in the Bible. Not one thing is a fact, but everything is true if you read it in the right context. It's all allegorical, it's all in parables, in stories. So for instance, when they talk about Jesus, the son of man, the son of God, they're talking about the son. Jesus, the son of God. We are all God collectively. Every single being in existence is God, is a drop in the ocean of consciousness. And God is basically energy, electromagnetic energy. That is all that God is. It's not some being with a beard sitting in a cloud somewhere, like many religious people think. God is energy. Everything is energy. So when we go back to that concept of the Holy Trinity, the Vedics explain it the best. They talk about Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. So they say, in this universe, all energy is divided into three things. Creative energy, energy of sustenance, and energy of destruction. So Brahma is creative energy, Vishnu is energy of sustenance, of life, and Vishnu is the energy of destruction, duality. Now, when you look even deeper into it, and you look at all the other cultures syncretically, you realize that every single ancient culture has a triad of gods. Every culture, you know, you go to the Greeks, they talk about Phanes and Zeus and Poseidon. When you go to the Christians, they talk about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Even mainstream science, protons, neutrons, electrons, there's always a Holy Trinity everywhere across the board. So this is where that Holy Trinity comes in. Now, I like to think of it as electromagnetic pulses of sine wave. So electricity, vibration, and magnetism. That is what everything is made up of. That is what God is. That is what all reality is. All reality is electromagnetic pulses of sine wave. Your soul, the true you, this flesh that we're in is an avatar. It's a meat suit. It's not the real us. The real us is the electromagnetic energy, the conscious energy that is within us, that is interacting through these physical bodies and physical constructs that we're in. I don't look to books anymore. If I want to find truth in anything, first I seek it within myself, and then I confirm it with nature. What is nature telling me? What do I observe? Because the sun never lies. The moon doesn't lie. Water does not lie. The oceans don't lie. The trees don't lie. If you observe the science of nature, you will discover the truth of our reality. So again, that number four is everywhere within our physical form. And according to the mystics, the number three is related to the metaphysical construct of our reality. Gravity does exist, but it's not a physical gravity. There's something called transcendental gravity. So remember, we're saying that our souls, when you pass on into the spirit world, your soul gravitates towards where you're meant to be going. So when you see those shooting stars in the sky, they are being drawn by electromagnetic gravity. They're gravitating to where they're meant to be going. But in this physical construct that we're in, again, we're told half-truths, gravity does not need to exist if the Earth is a plane, right? Up is up, down is down, just like our senses tell us, just like our everyday reality tells us. right? I am down because of mass, weight, and buoyancy, right? Those are things we can test. They're not theories. There isn't a theory of mass or a theory of weight. They're facts. But gravity is a theory. Why is it still a theory? Why isn't it just a fact? Because they're not telling us the truth of what gravity really is. They're telling us a half-truth. So they have to make it theoretical. They have to tell us the truth within the lie. So on a flat, motionless plane, I'm down because my weight or my mass is denser than the air around me. If you filled me up with helium, I would become lighter than the air around me, and I'll rise off the ground, right? I'll become buoyant. So that in itself is a basic, fundamental, scientific proof that gravity cannot exist. Because gravity cannot, unless you're saying gravity is magical, it's got the power to pull all the oceans, you know, flat to the surface. But it allows birds and butterflies and aeroplanes and helium balloons and smoke to freely rise off the ground. I mean, that in itself is mind-boggling. How we don't question that. I've gone so far down, it's not even a question for me anymore. I'm now seeking things beyond trying to prove that the Earth is flat, because it obviously is. There's no argument as far as I'm concerned. But there are people out there who are making fantastic videos and trying to change the paradigm and to get people to wake up to this huge, humongous deception that has been force-fed to the masses. It's a big spell. It literally is a magic spell. More people knew the Earth was flat than we are told. Most people were flat earthers pre-World War I. A man called John Gorst, he was a headmaster at a school here in England, and the article went viral all over the world. They were saying, why are you teaching them that we live on a ball? You're teaching them fake science. So when you look at that, you think, oh my goodness, schools were teaching flat earth science in 1901. You know, that in itself blew my mind. You know, it makes you question, maybe World War I and II were created to change that shift. And if you noticed, straight after World War II, television came in. Right, and then we saw the moon landing, and of course after that it was irrefutable. No one can now argue that the Earth is a ball, because we've seen it on TV. I've seen it with my own eyes on TV, so it must be a ball. Magic. And everyone falls for it. And of course everyone who's born after that, it's now in the schools. It's, you see how easy it is to change the reality that you're in within a very, very short space of time. When you look at free energy, going back to the torus fields. The torus fields are electromagnetic torus fields, right? And free energy, like Tesla said, is electromagnetism, right? So if everyone knows that the Earth is flat and we're surrounded by a field of energy that is an electromagnetic torus field, and we can tap into that electromagnetic torus field for free energy, then the controllers go out of business. There's no need for oil anymore. There's no need for, you know, all these, it would all go absolutely. We're tapping directly into free energy. So of course there's the thing of money.
We're in a strange state in the Earth right now, where we have six continents that we know about, and one continent that is in the dark to us, covered in ice, that is unknown to us.
Quite a big secret. People are smart.
A person is smart. People are dumb, panicky, dangerous animals, and you know it. 1,500 years ago, everybody knew the Earth was the center of the universe. 500 years ago, everyone knew the Earth was flat.